in early 68, this guy calls me up and we do the equivalent of a dope deal, except there's no money involved. You know, he surreptitiously hands me this cassette and says, don't tell anybody where you got this. And I take it home and listen to it and call up all my friends, and they come over and we all listen to it completely awestruck.
To me, it's always been a holy grail to actually fondle the original reels. You know, to actually to say, yeah, this is it. This is the real thing.
Well, the goal was to get as much out of the tapes as possible and to allow you to, you know, be on the stairs that led down to the basement so you could hear, what are those guys playing?
You're in the room. You're right there. You feel people breathing.
Everything that's been mythologized or turned into legend on behalf of what happened in that Woodstock basement in the summer of 67 is true.
The history of the reels themselves, I mean, this is like a detective story.
Robbie told me he remembered Bob saying, we ought to destroy this stuff. We ought to just erase it. What if we recorded songs that could never be released? What would they sound like? That's what you're hearing.
I think the basement tapes starts. I think there's no question with that world tour of 65, 66.
They were unbelievably grueling shows because, of course, everywhere Bob went, he was badly received by sections of the audience. At some shows, a large section of the audience turned on him, usually during the electric set.
It's a folk song. It's a folk song. I want to sing a folk song now.
People did feel that something had been taken away from them or something beautiful had been destroyed by Bob Dylan leaving the music of the people behind and going for the charts. It's taken as this outrage, as this sellout, as this betrayal. Dylan talked about it afterwards. He talked about it with a sense of great defiance.
Don't you think your first records were much better than the ones you do now?
Who said that?
With a sense of, you know, fuck you. This is the music I'm making. This is the music I want to sing. This is the music I want to play. If you don't like it, stay away.
Did you boo me last night?
I didn't.
We didn't boo you, Bob.
I didn't. Please, just a minute.
Well, I want the names of all the people that booed me.
First half, when they're all so quiet, I'll just break it. I'll play four or five songs, and they just don't make a sound. I'll just go, boo. Boo.
Robbie Robertson, Richard Manuel, Rick Danko, Garth Hudson, Lee Von Helm, they become Bob Dylan's band. These guys are now a band of brothers. This brings these people together. By the time they reach the United Kingdom in the spring of April 1966, they're meeting audiences that made the angry audiences they faced before it look like nothing. This is a war. People come in organized groups in order to stage walkouts. In other words, they're paying money not to see the show.
We pay to see a flipping folk singer, not big groups.
I don't believe you. You're a liar.
The effects were apocalyptic. Been touring since July 65 with people booing him. You can't do that for a year without it getting to you at some point. Effectively, you can carry on for so long like that. But when you get to the end, there's the crash. And the crash can be metaphoric or, as proved to be the case in Dylan's life, literal.
After that long, grueling tour, he was going to take a break June 1st, 1966. It was going to kick back up at the Yale Bowl on August 2nd, 1966, another whole leg of shows. And Dylan went back to Woodstock to relax.
They're supposed to be going back on the road to promote his new album, which had only come out a couple of weeks before the accident, Blonde on Blonde, except Bob didn't want to go back on the road.
He decides, I'm not going back to this crazy life, at least for a while. I'm gone. This is 1966. He doesn't go back on the road again till 1974. That's a long time. Dylan took a year and a half between Blonde on Blonde and John Wesley Harding. People referred to this as the period of silence, you know, as if this was some kind of strange violation of the rules of time and space. In record business terms, it was.
The guy's 25 years old. He's had this motorcycle accident. He has to come up with some sort of a battle plan. And this is one reason I find him so infatuating. I think, in a way, he doesn't. He knows he wants to regress, but he doesn't know exactly how. When he finally gets better, I think it was that point that Dylan had the moment of, what am I doing with my life? Could we not stop for a moment and reassess where we are and where I, Bob Dylan, want to go?
Dylan is saying, no, I'm not giving you a new album. No, I'm not going back on tour. No, no. You know, I've got a note from my doctor. It says I don't have to do this. I can stay home. And that's what he did.
This is January 67. So they haven't been recording. And Bob had ideas for a film. Originally, the idea of getting the guys to come up to Woodstock was actually to work on that.
And they're initially filmed backing Tiny Tim singing in the snow one morning. And then they continue on with other things.
And they work on the movie or they don't work on the movie. And they're bored. What are they going to do? That's the way these songs came together.
Initially, it was just that, getting back into playing music. Not making music, but playing music.
Initial sessions are held in the Red Room, Bob Dylan's own house. And in typical Bob Dylan fashion, I can report to you now that the Red Room wasn't red. It had previously been red, but it had been painted by the Dylans. The point of the Red Room sessions is it's where Bob Dylan starts to get his mojo back. Ooh, baby. Ooh. And they got all this equipment together to record this stuff, and I can just see all the hawks going, Garth, you know, you can figure out how that works, right?
Why don't you shut it off and I'll see how it's recording.
Well, we're living on the edge of the ocean with the mighty hunger ready for
crime. Fortunately, in this case, Garth Hudson is a very meticulous person who seemed to be the responsible party to put the tape recorder on top of his organ and a couple of mixers with microphones leading in and experiment how to record Red Room tapes. My understanding is that the microphone was put on top of a Wurlitzer electric piano, which was being played. It was like a little broadcast mic stand without rubber feet. The mic is picking up that vibration, and some of that stuff's pretty distorted, but there's still good music that you can hear through it.
They leave Dylan's house. And they go where? Well, they're gonna go to where the guys. There's no female presence, there's no family, there's no one to really bother, so they go to Big Pink. All is shaking
up. Rick Danko said, you have to understand, he said, this was a clubhouse. It was wonderful.
Big Pink's on the side of a hill. It's called the Basement Tapes because you leave the kitchen and walk down to it. And they started recording where the lion's share were done in the basement of Big Pink.
Well, those old hog bag strappers are a dime a dozen. And I can get a conk for a nickel. But look at what an earful I get, and it's awful too. Every time I try to go get a little tickle.
Somebody flicks the trigger, you know, and and suddenly the floodgates open. Well, you know, it's speculation when that happens. I mean, the evidence would appear to be that Tiny Montgomery, which is one of the acetate songs, is the first one to be recorded.
Well, you can tell everybody down in old Frisco, tell them Tiny Montgomery says hello. Get that bang, 'cause Tiny Montgomery's gonna shake that thing. Tell them everybody down in old Frisco that Tiny Montgomery's coming down to say hello.
And suddenly all the imagery and all the ideas that are gonna make the basement tapes this extraordinary body of work come together in one song, and it's there. And he kind of opens up the history of American popular music in this extraordinary way for these guys during these sessions.
You come in on the second line all the time. It's very easy. It like,
Robbie said at one point, Bob was very subtle about this.
Well, the high ship.
But he was taking us to school. He had prepped for this.
Told his deputy.
These very sessions when he would just drop in.
Johnny Todd, he took a notion, want to cross the ocean wide.
He'd come over with something he wanted them to learn. Folk, blues, country music, child ballads, contemporary folk music. Bob Dylan was teaching them. So here are these people. They learn to trust each other. They can pick up each other's cues. Nothing needs to be explained. They can work out arrangements together. They are all speaking the same language, and it's their language. And in a way, that's what the basement tapes are. It's five people, later six, speaking their own language.
Tears of rage, tears of grief. Why am I always the one who must be the thief? Come to me now, you know we're so alone. And life is green.
Once the dam burst, I mean, it really burst. I mean, he seems to have been turning out masterpieces on an almost daily basis.
An acetate is a recording. You give it to Jane or Joe so they can hear the song and learn it.
There were some acetates made that got distributed for the purpose of publishing demos.
I think they decided to do the acetate once they had recorded a whole slew of original songs that sounded great, that they were proud of, that weren't just fooling around, that weren't just experiments. These songs are demanding from the musicians who made them, finish me. And that's what happens with Tears of Rage, I Shall Be Released, Too Much of Nothing, so many other songs.
Too much of nothing can make a man ill at ease. One man's temper rises where another man's temper might freeze.
The hits that came out of the basement tapes were people like the Byrds and Manfred Mann and Fairport Convention. Quinn the Eskimo, how the guys in Manfred Mann picked that and pulled it out, it's great.
Come all without, come all within. You'll not see nothing like the mighty wind. Come all without, come all within. You'll not see nothing like the mighty wind.
You Ain't Going Nowhere, it's just one of the funniest things you'll ever hear. Here is a song that everybody knows. You know, the Byrds obviously put it out as a single. It had been covered a million times, and it has that very, very memorable chorus. You know, ooh-wee, ride me high, you know, today's the day my bride's gonna come. And suddenly you hear this version where he's almost sending himself up. You know, you ain't no bunch of basement, you know, you ain't no head of lettuce. Just a bunch of basement noise, yeah.
Look here, you bunch of basement noise.
I mean, just what is going on, you know?
Head of lettuce, feed that buzzard, lay him on the rug.
Yeah, they're definitely having a good time on that one. The original publishing demos start to circulate in 1968. They get bootlegged on vinyl in 1969.
Two well-meaning, long-haired guys in Los Angeles, California, decided that they would create a Bob Dylan album of this material that they had heard, they had assembled as Dylan fanatics, that no one else had heard, none of the general public had heard. And they created a very haphazard 2-LP set called The Great White Wonder. It was the first pop music bootleg of any real substance. It was literally just a white cover that they had a rubber stamp made that said Great White Wonder, and they went, next. It's not a great recording. Some of the basement tape songs are running fast. They didn't cut the record particularly well, but how could they? They were enthusiastic amateurs that loved Bob Dylan. Who would have dreamed that in Sweden, a guy took their stuff, added a couple things, and put out another one? Who would have known a guy in New York would have, you know? And this whole thing was like throwing the pebble in the placid lake, and the waves go like this. People started bootlegging the bootleg.
Almost immediately, and possibly even simultaneously, other people who got hold of the full acetate started issuing just the acetate. And the proliferation was so extreme that there's no way of cataloging who was doing what.
It didn't just start a minor Bob Dylan fan club, it started a whole bootleg industry.
There's a cover story in Rolling Stone by Jan Wenner saying Bob Dylan's basement tape, and that's what it was referred to as, the tape, the basement tape, not tapes, should be released. And he made an argument about how this music not only was terrific, but it was a different way of looking at the world, and it had to be released. And why in the world wasn't it? Didn't make any sense. It was a secret hidden in plain sight. You know, all these songs were on the radio, so why not put it out? Good question. By 1975, the band needed a boost, and I think putting this stuff out was a way to make that happen. Plus, the music was obviously stuff that the world ought to hear. Even if Bob Dylan said he didn't understand why it made the top 10, he thought everybody already had them.
And Bob agreed to let them put it out.
I remember John Rockwell in the New York Times said, it was the greatest record of the Western popular music sphere, period. That's a paraphrasing, but he did, he wrote that. When the 2-LP set came out in 1975, it should have, in theory, one might think, quenched the thirst of the public with the basement tapes. Bah!
People are going, what the hell's this? Probably the two most famous songs on the basement tapes are missing. I mean, I Should Be Released and Mighty Quinn are not on.
If anything, it was like putting kerosene on that flame, and the basement tapes myth got another rocket boost.
It very quickly, people realized that this isn't it. This we need more.
There must be more. Can't there be more? Sure there's more. We hope there's more. And the fans got out there and doing their detective work, soon found out these guys recorded for months. Anybody else, the 2-LP set would have come out, oh great, that's what they did, this is great, now we've got it. But the Dylan fans, they began to dig, and they found out there was a lot more stuff done there, and it took 40-something years, but here we are.
Ain't no more keen on rising.
Stuff came out in dribs and drabs, on LPs that included tons of other stuff, on tapes that people passed from hand to hand.
Then in 1986, several reel-to-reels turned up. Recordings of Dylan and the band doing reams and reams of country and folk and all this amazing material that nobody knew about. And they came out on two famous double album bootlegs. Those tapes originally came from an ex-roadie of the band. And then 6 years later, another ex-roadie of the band helped himself to another bunch of tapes that were lying around in Garth's lockup and released those. Suddenly, the scale of the amount of material that had been recorded becomes more than one can necessarily comprehend.
Down the streets, the dogs are barking, and the day is growing dark. Cause I'm one too many mornings and a thousand miles.
My eyes, they begin to fade.
One Too Many Mornings with Richard and Bob singing. The Richard part has been inaudible. You cannot hear it because the left channel is recorded so low, and we're able to raise and level the channels and then get rid of a lot of the swirl of the hiss on top so that their voices could be equal. Now, for the first time on this set, you can hear Richard and Dylan sing that song at the same time.
Finally are getting the real basement tapes because they're off the real reels. And even in the instances where they can't get access to the real reels, nothing is more than first generation.
Someone must explain, so as long as it takes to do this.
There is one tape called GH01, the Garth Hudson 01 reel, which is the tape that he mixed. That was the model that we went after to how do you finish them. We'd follow what Garth did. It was great to work with Garth. It was great having him be there and touch it again and bless it and give his approval for it to come out.
It's great that we've got 30 songs that haven't been in circulation, and some of which are as great as anything we've previously heard.
I don't hurt anymore.
The basement tapes are masterclass in Americana. They help codify it. They help define it. This is why the Americana acts of today all revere the basement tapes. It's why I feel the basement tapes, and so many others feel the basement tapes, are important. If you'll allow me to say the inverted comma is important. Certain records or moments in time are culturally important, and the basement in Woodstock is one of those times.
These people, think about it. They're looking at the past.
If your memory serves you well.
And they're learning from the past, and they're listening to the past.
And wait. So I'm going to unpack all my.
But the idea that if the past isn't alive in you, then the future will be empty. That's what the music says.
No man alive.
That's what was so different.
To you. With another tape.
The notion that these are guys are 23, 24, 25 is just nuts.
The quote-unquote holy grail, as some people say, maybe it's the ultimate bootleg. Maybe it is. Because when you talk about bootlegs, what has been more desired than this?
Wasting tape.